Welcome, ladies and gentlemen. Please find your seats. Our session is about to begin.
Please welcome the founder and president for the Institute for Governance and Sustainable Development, Derwood Zailka.
Everyone who came to this beautiful city and this beautiful summit, we're facing an existential crisis of climate change. We're at 1 degree of warming. We're moving in perhaps 10 years to the dangerous 1.5 level, another 10, 15 years to 2 degrees. And we need to do more than just cut CO2, responsible for half of our warming, if we're going to avert the existential crisis. So what if we had a strategy that could cut the rate of global warming in half? What if we had a strategy that could cut the rate of Arctic warming by two-thirds? What if we had a strategy that could avoid twice as much warming at mid-century as our strategy cutting CO2? A strategy that could avoid up to 0.6 degrees of warming compared to 0.3 or less from CO2. What if we had a strategy that could also save millions of lives every year and 100 million tons of crops? What if we had a strategy where we knew the technologies that could do all of these things and that had delivery mechanisms for most of them already? And we have that strategy, of course. It's the strategy to take out the short-lived super pollutants. You can't win climate without this. And you can't win in the long run unless we win in the short run. So the existential crisis includes the tipping points we face between 1.5 and 2 degrees. There's a cluster of 12 tipping points. We're already tipping the dominoes over that are causing the self-reinforcing feedbacks to accelerate. So warming today is moving faster than yesterday without us putting any more climate pollution into the system. And it's axiomatic, you can't solve a fast-moving, indeed an accelerating problem, unless you speed up your solutions. As Bill McKibben said, winning slowly is the same as losing in climate change. And the strategy of the short-lived climate pollutants is how we win fast. And we took out one of them with the Montreal Protocol and the Kigali Amendment. That's going to avoid up to 0.5 degrees of warming by the end of the century. And if we improve the efficiency of cooling devices, we can double that to a full 1 degree. But now we need to focus on black carbon, on methane, on tropospheric ozone, and improve the delivery mechanisms, the governance mechanisms for these other short-lived climate pollutants. And we need to step up the governance. We have CARB, which has been brilliant on this strategy. We have some other states who are doing a lot. And we have the Climate and Clean Air Coalition, the CCAC, 61 countries, another double that with the NGO community. It's doing a great job, and I was just talking to Jonathan Pershing in the back, who I was reminded of was the first co-chair of the CCAC when this institution was first created, and it rocked. Now we've hit a plateau, and we need more funding to accelerate what we're going to do on short-lived climate pollutants. But what's it worth to get all the benefits that we just described? Now, the reason we know so much about short-lived climate pollutants is because of one professor, Professor Ramanathan. So Ram is the man who built the base camp, to use Jerry Brown's analogy, for beginning the assault of the summit. And Ram has just won the Tang Prize. He shared it with Jim Hansen, one of the most prestigious prizes you can get in this field. And I was one of the people who wrote a supporting letter, along with several Nobel laureates and a whole host of scientists who knew that Ram deserved this recognition. And a couple of the points that I think are worth mentioning for his career start with 1975. So in 1974, Mario Molina and Sherry Rowland told us that CFCs were destroying stratospheric ozone. The next year, 1975, Ram says, by the way, these are potent greenhouse gases. This started a whole movement to look at the other trace gases or non-CO2 gases and to see that they were responsible for half of warming and could be responsible for much more avoided warming. So Ram started us on this path. Ram is the one who in the 1980, I think it was 1980, predicted when we detect the warming signal in 2000. Ram was the one who put together the Atmospheric Brown Cloud Program. Ram is not just a modeler, although he's quite accomplished in that, but he's somebody who measures and gets his own data. He knows how to get the drones flying through the Atmospheric Brown Cloud to tell us exactly what the composition is and what we need to do to solve it. What I like perhaps most about Ram, however, is that he is a policy-relevant scientist. He knows what's important to move policy. So in the Kigali Amendment strategy, we're moving along and we're teaching people that we can avoid X watts per square meter in radiative forcing. And we move and tell them we can avoid up to 100 billion tons of CO2 equivalent. These are metrics that people don't understand, but Ram put together a team to calculate the avoided warming of up to a half a degree Celsius. That became the mantra for President Obama, for Secretary of State John Kerry, and for many other ministers around the world. They understood that was a huge prize if we could move to the end game with Kigali. So Ram started in 75 to tell us these were climate warmers. Moving all the way, this was 2009, I believe, when he did this paper, to telling us the key piece of data to actually succeed with the Kigali Amendment. So I had the pleasure of having dinner last night with Ram. He asked me and Mario Molina to join him, and I thought, well, this will just be a celebration. You know, Ron's got a lot to celebrate. But no, it was a working meeting. And at the end of the meeting, I came away with another list that I'm going to do for Ram. So may I welcome my great friend, Professor Ramanathan. Thank you.
Durwood, thank you so much. I was back there listening to what Durwood was saying, and my feeling was I should leave the stage. I don't think I can better what he said. So I think I also want to thank the governor and the California government and Ryan McCarthy for organizing the Super-Pollutant session. So just to start, we are all experiencing extreme weather, more intense than what it was before. So you ask why? The answer is loud and clear. With very little scientific uncertainty, we are experiencing extreme weather because we have made new climate. And I wish I had thought of saying that. This was declared by the American Meteorological Society last November, one of the most cautious conservative scientific societies in the US, All climate scientists belong to that, and all weather forecasters. So with that, now that that's established, the extreme weather are getting more extreme because we have made a new climate. So the question is, what is in store for us? In about 10 to 13 years, the planet is going to warm from 1 degree now to 1.5. So you may think, what's a half a degree? Basically, physically, thermodynamically, what it means is that all the forces behind the extremes, heat waves, floods, fires, storms, hurricanes, are going to be 50% larger, the underlying force. And so we go merrily along. What happens another 20 years later, now I'm in the mid-1940s, the planet would shoot past 2 degrees. So those underlying forces would intensify by 100%, okay? So now let me give you another metric. This is based on tremendous amount of studies which are published just in the last 3 to 4 years. When you go from 1.5 to 2 degrees, that's roughly about 2030 to 2045, we'll be exposing 1.7 billion people to extreme heat waves. And the rains, which gives these floods, would intensify by another 1/3. And about 250 million more people would be exposed to droughts. So we have a chance to not let that happen. Can we cool the climate or mitigate so that it stays at 1.5? The only practical and demonstrable way I know, and hopefully others, is to target the super pollutants. There are 4 of them. Durwood already mentioned that about you. Methane, black carbon, ozone in the lower atmosphere, a powerful greenhouse gas, and HFCs used as refrigerants. This is where Durwood has pioneered, along with Maria Molina of the Kigali Protocol. You'll hear about that. So I think the panels, we're going to discuss how exactly we can cut them down, but I'll tell you how much. We have to cut the black carbon by 80%, methane by about 40 to 50%, anthropogenic methane emissions, and we have to phase out HFCs. If we do all this by 2030, we can keep that warming at 1.5, at least till 2050, around, give or take a few tenths of a degree. So what are the measures? Just to give you an example on black carbon, just provide clean cooking to 3 billion poor people we have left behind with 18th century technology for no fault of their own. They just didn't have, we didn't give them access. And the second is put diesel particulate filters on all diesel vehicles, off-road and on-road. And there are filters available, and the ICCT can tell you how to do this. And the second for methane, it's the best example. All we have to do is recover methane from the landfills, from the food we throw into the landfill, recover methane from water treatment plants, recover methane from farm manure, and then avoid leaking gas pipes. Just simple, practical things. I would like to add one measure, and I hope CARB and CCAs and others are listening. If we ban throwing food into landfill, okay, we can save enormous amount of methane from leaking into the atmosphere. And it's easily done. What we need to do is develop micro-scale biodigesters at the scale of an individual restaurant, at the scale of a new superstore. Put your food waste there. You know, I don't know how many of you know, we throw 40% of the food. When we talk about climate change, they say go to plant-based diet and all that. It's all important. But the first thing we can do is don't throw that food away. So that's what, how do I made a claim it's demonstrable. California, thanks to our Senator Lara, who authored this bill, you'll hear from him this afternoon, and our Governor Jerry Brown, has passed a law, bill, to cut down these super pollutants exactly along the magnitude talked about. Then comes CCAC. It has 61 nations as partners, 67, another 60 banks, foundations, jurisdictions. So they're ready to go. So this is eminently doable. So I talked about keeping the warming at 1.5 till 2050. What do we do beyond that? So that's where carbon neutrality kicks in. If we start the carbon neutrality now, many have already started. We heard many commitments, and achieve it by 2050, then we have a fighting chance to keep the warming around 2 degrees beyond 2050. So the curve is going like this. The super-pollutant will start bending the curve by 2030 and keep it 1.5. If you don't do anything, it'll race up. And if the carbon neutrality kicks in by 2050, that'll keep it bent, but it'll shoot up by about 0.5 degree. What happens then? So we want to be sure, with at least 70% probability, we just got to suck that carbon dioxide out of the air. It's called carbon extraction. We don't have technologies. People are thinking about it. We start developing it, and by 2040, we get to the scale where we can take out 10 billion tons. Then I would say there is at least a 50 to 60% probability to keep the warming at 1.5. And don't forget, why am I so harping on 1.5? Between 1.5 to 2 degrees, we are talking about 1.7 billion people exposed. We can save them, protect them. So the best way to think about this is like a relay race. There are three runners: super pollutants, carbon neutrality, carbon extraction. The first runner is the super pollutant, because she's going to bend that curve. We have the superwoman with CCAC put out, right? And then by the time the carbon neutrality runner is the second runner, she will give that baton to the carbon neutrality runner. And that runner would keep the warming around 2, at least till 2070. Meantime, the finisher, the carbon extraction, comes in and finishes the race and keeping the planet at 1.5 degrees. So why am I claiming, bringing this metaphor, a relay race? Right now, if you go to UNFCCC plenary meeting, or in this summit, I was pushing hard on the governor to put super pollutants on the plenary. It's mainly carbon neutrality, the discussion. It has to be, because that's the bigger challenge. But I want to go out on the record saying, by itself, it's not going to avoid the 2-degree warming. So what we need is a relay race strategy. We need three runners, and talk about an integrated way. It has to be discussed in the plenary. Because when I talk about super pollutants, even to our Governor Jerry Brown, he says, Ram, it looks like this is your pet project. I don't hear it when I go to President Xi, meet him, or heads of states. So it's got to get into the plenary, and we got to have an integrated strategy. There are three runners. You can't finish the race with just one runner. That runner is going to lose out of gas. Thank you.
Good afternoon, or good morning, everyone. It's really nice to be here with all of you. There's something about hearing from Dr. Ramanathan and then, of course, from Derwood Zelke, who've both been involved and have had such an extraordinary history in delivering on this particular agenda that makes it really hard to follow. And in some ways, what we've now got is we've set the stage, set the scene, and I think we now have a series of panelists, first on the issues of black carbon, second on the issues of HFCs, and third on the issues of methane, that will make very concrete the kinds of things that people are doing to address the problem. We've heard a very clear articulation of the scale of the problem. We've heard a very clear articulation about the kinds of general solutions we'll now hear specifics about things that people are doing. And I have the privilege today of moderating really a very interesting first part of our discussion on the issues of black carbon. And the people sitting on the stage alongside of me, Drew Kojak, who is the International Council on Clean Transportation, the Vice Minister of Global Environmental Affairs, Ministry of Environment, Minister Takahashi, and then from the Secretary of Environment from Hong Kong, Mr. Wang, who will speak to us about these issues. I'd like to start off first, if I might, with Mr. Takahashi, who's really been looking at Japanese commitments and actions, in particular on short-lived pollutants, with black carbon as a focus. And I'd like to ask you, sir, might you tell us a bit about the new things that you're doing? Give us a sense of the advances that have been made in Japan.
Thank you. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. It's my great pleasure to attend this session. I'd like to start my story a little bit historically in Japan. On black carbon, we started the regulation in 1960s, and we gradually reduced the emission of particles such as black carbon from both stationary and mobile sources. And as a result, black carbon amount emitted in Japan has substantially decreased compared with a certain period in the past. And in consideration of the fact that black carbon is a short-lived climate pollutant, SLCP, will implement measures to further reduce black carbon emissions, including strengthening the regulation on gas exhaust from automobiles and examining an additional measures to reduce smoke and cost soot emissions. And black carbon is more important in developing countries, including Asian countries. So as for the international cooperation, Japan contributed $12.5 million over 5 years from 2013 to 2017 to support the Climate and Clean Air Coalition, so-called CCAC, and related activities. In particular, for the implementation of measures against the open burning of waste, as well as for the formulation of action plans by countries. In addition, through the joint crediting mechanisms, JCM, promoted by Japan mainly in developing countries in Asia, the use of renewable energy and energy conservation have been fostered to cut the use of fossil fuels, which represent a major source of black carbon. For example, Japan gave support to the introduction of highly efficient Japanese transformers to local power distribution networks in some areas in Vietnam, as a result of the transformers being proven to be effective for energy conservation. The local procurement criteria were improved, and the use of such transformers was autonomously expanded across Vietnam and also to other countries, leading to substantial energy conservation. Moreover, in Mongolia, 350 megawatt solar power generation facilities were installed through the combination of JCM and support from other financial institutions, including ADB. Furthermore, Japan launched the Asia Pacific Clean Air Partnership, we call it APCAP, in cooperation with the UNEP, with a view to promoting anti-air pollution measures in the Asia Pacific region, including those to reduce black carbon emissions, and has been given both financial and technological support to APCAP initiatives. Under the auspices of the Secret Science Panel, which was established under the APCAP, researchers from Asian countries analyzed the current status of air pollution and decided on 25 measures to be focused on going forward, giving scientific consideration to the issue. The solution report, in which the determined measures are described, will be widely disclosed at the CCAC's working group meeting to be held in Bangkok this October. I expect that effective anti-air pollution measures will be implemented across the Asia-Pacific region based on this solution report. Thank you.
Thank you so much. It's really exciting to hear about the broad things that are happening both in Japan and then collectively support you're providing to the rest of the world. So thank you so much for that. Let me turn next with the same kind of question to Drew Kojak, who's the executive director of the International Council on Clean Transportation. We heard from Dr. Ramanathan, but we know, those of us in this room, transport a huge share from incomplete combustion leading to black carbon emissions. Drew, let me ask you the same question. Tell us a little bit about the things that you're currently working on that are opening the door to some successes here.
Delighted to, and good morning, everybody. As Jonathan said earlier, we're trying to give you very, very concrete examples of what's happening today. And let me start just by grounding you all in what's happened in the United States. In 2001, the US EPA passed a regulation that required all diesel vehicles to have diesel particulate filters and selective catalytic reduction starting in 2006 and phasing into 2012. At the time, we described that rulemaking as the equivalent of deleting gasoline and putting catalytic converters on all gasoline vehicles, just to give you a sense of just how massive and profound that change was. At the time when we wrote the rule, we never mentioned black carbon. We never mentioned climate change. It was all about public health. Today, there are only a handful of nations that have similar regulations. Japan does, Europe does, Canada does, Korea does. It's about 40% of heavy-duty vehicles sold into the global marketplace have diesel particulate filters. So 60% are without. And that therein lies the great opportunity for massive improvements in public health and massive improvements in lowering black carbon and improving our efforts to deal with climate change. So one of the good news stories here today is that China, the world's largest heavy-duty vehicle market, and India, a huge population, and Mexico are all poised to adopt and implement those same regulations by 2021. In our estimate at the ICCT, that will be the equivalent of reducing 100,000 premature deaths in 2030 and have major impacts on reducing black carbon and improving our efforts to deal with climate change. Another thing that we're doing at the ICCT is that we're working with mayors around the world and with major heavy-duty vehicle manufacturers, Cummins, Volvo, Scania, BYD, to decarbonize bus fleets around the world. And we're getting pledges from mayors for soot-free clean buses. So it's either soot-free diesel or electrified buses as soon as possible, and then getting the manufacturers to commit to providing those products to those cities. Right. And I think I'll stop there. We're doing work on the Kigali Amendment as well, and trying to work in different countries to get low GWP refrigerants into motor vehicle air conditioners. That is a massive opportunity as well, an implementation, to get back to your point about concrete actions. And I'll end with a slight sour note, in that, unfortunately, one of the best regulations in the world to deal with motor vehicle refrigerants and air conditioning is here in the United States, and that regulation is currently at risk of being rolled back.
Thanks very much, Drew. I think one of the points you're making about the health impacts here is essential. One of the things we know about black carbon, it does have these direct consequences to people's welfare, as well as being a significant contributor to the near-term forcings of climate change. One of the areas, of course, that we worry about in the context of that is in port facilities. And we have with us for our third panelist, the Honorable Mr. Wong from Secretary of Environment from Hong Kong. They've been doing a lot of work in this domain on shipping. Why don't you tell us a little bit about the work that you're doing both in that and in other areas?
Okay, good morning. Hong Kong is working on two environmental blueprints, one on Hong Kong's Clean Air Plan, the other is Hong Kong's Climate Action Plan 2030 Plus. They're addressing different scopes of works, but they overlapped and addressing the issues that we are talking about today. Basically that we are working on the not only the emissions from the ships, but also from the road transportation. In Hong Kong, we have three major air pollutant sources, from the power plants, from the road transportation, and the marine transportation. For instance, in Hong Kong, in the past few years, we have been reducing the major air pollutants, including PM, by around 30% within 5 years. One of the major initiatives is to phase out the old diesel commercial vehicles. We are using about $1.5 billion to phase out all the old diesel commercial vehicles within, say, a few years. It's accounting to about 80,000 old diesel commercial vehicles. It's probably one of the biggest phasing out schemes in the world. But in Hong Kong, locally, the biggest air pollutants in terms of PM or SO2 are from the ships, because Hong Kong is one of the biggest container ports in the world. And more than that, close to Hong Kong, we have Shenzhen and other southern China ports. They are also one of the biggest container ports in the world. So Hong Kong is more serious about the pollution from the marine transportation. 2 years ago, Hong Kong became the first port in the whole Asia with the law requiring the ocean-going vessels, when they are at berth in Hong Kong, they must use cleaner fuel. The next step would happen in January next year. We collaborate with Shenzhen and Guangdong to form the first ever emission control area in Asia. That means when the ocean-going vessels get near the water of Pearl Delta, they must start to use cleaner fuel. So I think that that will further improve the air quality and address the black carbon challenge in our region. Thank you.
Thanks so much. I think what's exciting about this is we've got three quite different pieces of the puzzle. We've got the discussions on black carbon from things like cook stoves and development power plants. We've got things on some of the road areas that are working, and we've got the whole marine conversation. What's interesting to me is to think about how we take all of this forward. And we've got enormous opportunities, some of which have been seized here. But I'd like to ask one other question of each of you and see what you might react to this. Clearly, there are still barriers in the way of taking next steps to further reduce our black carbon emissions. So I want to know from you what you think the primary barrier is, and if it could be removed or reduced, what else could you do? How could you further advance this agenda, which contributes so much to the short-term forcing globally? So let me start first in the opposite direction, and maybe I could start first with the minister.
Okay, very good question. While we are doing aggressively on cleaning up the air and also address the decarbonization challenge, Hong Kong is a relatively small city, okay, even though it has about 7 million population. So the next step probably would be more about the regional collaboration, Hong Kong, Shenzhen, Guangdong. And now under mainland China's policy is the Greater Bay Area. That means economically, socially, and environmentally that we would have closer collaborations so that we can address the issues about air quality, black carbon, and decarbonization. Mm-hmm.
Thank you very much. Drew?
That was fast. I'll give a couple different perspectives on that. Really good question, Jonathan. The first is, once countries have low sulfur diesel fuel, which is difficult to achieve, it requires a massive investment in refineries, but once you have it, it is a starting gun to get diesel particulate filters to clean up all diesels on the road, right? So that is diesel trucks and buses, that is non-road equipment, that is construction, that is agriculture, that is marine. It is a huge challenge, but a huge opportunity. And so in China, in India, in Mexico, now that those fuels are available, this is a starting gun, and that's a massive opportunity. So that's number one. Number two, we've got a suite of zero emission vehicle technologies that are coming online on heavy duties, right? From Nikola Motors working with Bosch for hydrogen fuel cell long haul tractor trailer trucks. We have Elon Musk coming forward with a battery electric big rig. A year ago, everyone would have laughed that that would ever be done, right? Europe is very, very hot on e-roads, electrifying roads, right? So removing the barriers technologically to get those into the marketplace is another huge opportunity for us. The last thing I'll say is that policymakers need to start to think about incorporating what I'll call targeted EV policies into future motor vehicle emission standards. And that's something like the California ZEV mandate, but China has a different version, Europe has a different version. Whatever the versions are, we need to start accelerating those zero emission technologies into all parts of the heavy duty vehicle sector. And we need to take opportunity every time we can.
So a lot of barriers, but a lot of opportunity.
Yeah.
Thanks very much. Mr. Takahashi, I wonder if you might say a few words about barriers, and if we remove them, what you could do additionally.
Thank you. I would like to point out one area. I think the one problem is a lack of data, emission data. It is very important to have good data to identify priority areas and also identify potential of further reduction. So at the COP23 last year, we launched a new initiative to improve the, to cooperate with developing countries to improve the capacity to for emission data, in particular emission from the private sectors. So we'd like to start this cooperation next week in Tokyo. I will sign the MOU with the Indonesian ministry to start cooperation. But it's one example. But I think we if we have a good data, we can those countries have a can have their own plan to integrate those emission reductions in the national development policy. Thank you.
Well, thank you all very, very much. I think we've had some really interesting opening framings of very concrete actions on the port side, in the transport sector, across the board with developing countries, and support might be provided. Let me give a big round of applause to this particular panel, and thank you all so much. And we're all of you. So as you can see, we've got enormous interest in this particular question, which has to do with HFCs. And we've got an extraordinary group of people who've been working on this agenda as well. Many of you are following this with some excitement, because I think a lot is going on this particular front. And as you heard, I think, from Dr. Ramanathan, if we are successful in meeting the various commitments that we've made at a global level, this particular set of actions could fundamentally change the trajectory of emissions and global warming. And for that reason, there are a lot of people who are working on it, and what we're going to do is hear what some of them are doing. So without introducing them all as I start, let me start off first with a question to Sanjeev Rastogi, who's the Vice President and General Manager at Honeywell, for a bit of an industry perspective. But let me ask you a question, sir. A lot is going on. Could you tell us just a bit about what Honeywell is doing?
Okay. So maybe I'll rewind a little bit on what Honeywell has done, right? So one of the things for us when we looked at the world in the mid-2000s, we could see that HFCs were going to get phased out at some point in time and regulations were coming, right? So that was back in, say, 2004, 2006 timeframe. And at that point, we decided that we needed to do something about it. So we started investing in research programs to actually come up with molecules which were lower in climate impact than HFCs. then over the last decade or so, we've invested about $1 billion in the research as well as manufacturing capabilities. We've commercialized 3 new molecules, which are in some cases, or in many cases, 1,000 times lower in global warming than the products that they replace, the HFC products that they replace. And we are selling these products globally in the US, in Europe, in Asia, and even in China. China is one of our big markets, actually, for our HFO platform.
Thank you very much. I'm impressed, actually, with the quality and the quantity of work that's gone in. And I think that all of us can think about where we could contribute. It's this really quite extraordinary commitment that Honeywell has made. Let me turn next, not in the order that you're all sitting, but with some different questions for people on the panel. I wanted to turn next, if I could, to Rhea Su. Rhea is the president of the Natural Resources Defense Council. And there's been a whole context. We have first a collective industry perspective with one company acting actively. We now have a perspective perhaps more of a state level from some of the advocacy community. How do you see it? What are you guys working on? Tell us a bit about what's going forward.
Well, thank you, Jonathan, and thank you, everybody, for being here today. I couldn't agree with your opening statement more. There is a lot of stuff going on here, and I think all of us are really excited to attest to that work, and that work is at multiple levels. As you said, there's a lot of great work happening in the business community. We'll hear shortly about the fantastic work happening at the state level. But I just have to say very quickly, I mean, I think that HFCs and their predecessor CFCs is really one of the greatest stories around advocacy in pursuit of global solutions. Obviously, we came up with a global solution with respect to the CFCs. Now we have the HFCs, and despite the very, very good work still continuing reality of Kigali, we are obviously seeing, certainly within the United States, some pullback, both within the context of the federal administration as well as in the context of the courts. So despite the progress that we've made in the past, we are finding some challenges. But interestingly enough, I think those challenges are now not only being confronted by advocacy organizations like NRDC, where we're fighting hard with our litigation pretty much every day, they are being confronted by the leaders that you see sitting here on this panel today. Leadership that is emerging from industry, leadership that is emerging from states. There's at least probably a half a dozen states, including California, New York, Maryland, who have announced they're going to move forward with HFC standards regardless of whatever the United States does nationally. So I think that this is a really exciting moment. I think it's an illustrative moment of the reality, both of momentum, the reality of the fact that these solutions are solutions where multiple parties, advocacy, business, political leadership are coming together and moving this forward again despite the political circumstances we might see in the United States.
Thanks very much, Rhea. I had you go first because I wanted to frame the broad context, and next I wanted to turn to Senator Lara from California because I think you'll make very particular and specific what kinds of things are being done, and if you might say a few words about the bill.
Absolutely, thank you. Is this working?
Try again.
Got it? I'll just take
the camera. You know, technology doesn't always work. Well, it's great to welcome all of you here to California, and it's absolutely true. There's so much work being done in this space, and actually, as of yesterday, thanks to Governor Brown's signature of our legislation, California now becomes the only state in the nation to have an incentive program to phase down HFCs, and we join Canada, Germany, and Japan. And for us, you know, it's really, again, given the unfortunate situation we find ourselves at the federal government, it's up to California again to lead and to act. And kudos to our industry partners who have also stepped up with us and actually worked with us on this legislation to ensure that we incentivize the phase down, that we prioritize those equipments that get the most bang for our buck, and that we also focus on supermarkets, which we know nationally to around 20% leakage at the national level. And so now for us to utilize the resources we do have to get us to a point where we start phasing down this equipment at our ports, at our, most, and they tend to affect our, low income communities the most. And so it's vital for California to lead. We're leading with our industry partners, demonstrating that regardless of who's in the White House, we're going to continue to push on this phase, these critical phase down. So what we did in California is essentially put a reduction target of 40% by 2030. We initially put in-state statute the EPA regulations that were in place before this administration. And now this incentive program allows us to continue to work with industry on our critical phase down and be able to provide the resources they need, and particularly as some of these high cost replacement infrastructure that needs to happen. And so for us, it's another proud moment to showcase the world what we're doing and to be able to have the governor sign the bill yesterday, although on a boat, which was kind of rocky and windy. But again, California is proud to lead in this space and very proud of our partners and our NGOs that have been working with us on this for several years.
So Senator, I really wanted to congratulate you on your work on that bill. It's truly a significant achievement. Sends, I think, a signal that all of us are hoping to have more of. So really, congratulations.
Thank you. Thank you. Really, everybody's victory here on this table. Thank you.
Indeed, but it takes some special leaders to move it forward. So really you. Appreciate your work.
Gracias.
Yeah, absolutely. Let me turn next, if I could, to Joe Trauger. Joe is with us from the Air Conditioning, Heating, and Refrigeration Institute. And if we take a look at one end at the policy side, we also have the other end, the umbrella of a set of companies working with not just with Honeywell, but across the board. Could you say a few words about the things that you've done and how you see some of these next steps?
Sure. Well, just to give a little bit of background on AHRI, is this on?
It's on, but too quiet.
Well, I'll just give you just a little bit of background on AHRI and who we represent to kind of set the stage a little bit. So AHRI is the Air Conditioning, Heating, Refrigeration Institute. We have about 300 plus members, and we represent manufacturers of the heating, ventilation, air conditioning, refrigeration, and water heating industry. So very much interested in all of these issues related to HFCs. Our industry represents about $46 billion annually in output and about $256 billion in economic activity every year. So we're looking at these issues from certainly from an industry perspective, and you know, I'm happy to be here in support of not only the climate conference, but also to, I think, make a pretty momentous announcement. In the fact that the industry is, after we get done with this panel discussion, I'm going to transmit a letter to the Air Resources Board that we signed jointly with the Natural Resources Defense Council and a number of our companies to support the work that's happening in California that Senator Lara was engaged in, and also the next phase of implementation here in California. And specify an actual date for phased out of the use of HFCs in 2023. So we're very excited to make that announcement, and like I said, the letter will be transmitted after this panel. It was a spirited discussion among our industry, as you could imagine. But at the end of the day, we reached a decision point, and we think this is a pivotal moment for the environment and the industry. Our preference is to engage and have a national policy when it comes to HFCs. That's certainly our preference. But recognizing that the state of California wanted to move a little sooner, we felt it was important to be part of that discussion, and that's why we did what we did. That being said, we're continuing to push at the federal level to adopt Kigali and implement it at the federal level.
Thanks so much, Joe, and congratulations on that. I was talking to Joe briefly before we came on, and Joe told me he was doing internal cartwheels on the airplane, and I want to know if they were kind of manifest for the room and the audience at large and the rest of the airport. But it's great to have him here. It's a fabulous announcement. I think it makes very concrete that the policy can happen, but you have to have the corporate engagement. You have to have people buying in, and the buy-in that's reflected there is significant, not just for California, but I would argue globally. Mm-hmm. I'd like to turn next, if I could, to the global conversation. Because we've got a couple of key people here involved in that. And I wanted to start off first with India, because we all know that the significant emissions from air conditioning in the future, they are going to matter. And yet, it can't possibly be a scenario in which India can cope with the enormous rise in temperature without some way to address that in people's lives and buildings. We have with us today Arvind Kumar, who's the Principal Secretary from the Municipal Administration and Urban Administration from the state of Telangana in India, affected both by temperatures and working on this problem. Tell us a bit about what's going on in the state and how you see the solutions here for HFCs.
Thank you. So firstly, this Telangana state is the newest state. It was formed about 4 years ago. So we are just 4-year-old state. And talking about municipal administration in India, I would like to kind of say that we operate at two levels. So at one level, we are kind of being challenged by low capacities, low resource mobilization, trying to meet the drinking water requirements and sewage disposal and things like that. And on the other hand, we have to talk about energy conservation and take necessary actions. So I just wanted to put things in perspective. Having said that, I'll say that we are trying to tackle this issue at three levels. So first is building code, and I'm happy to announce that Hyderabad, the city where I come from, is the first city in India to have mandatorily made it compulsory to have ECBC, Energy Conservation Building Code, applicable to all new buildings which are in the plot size of more than 1,000 square meters or the built-up area of more than 2,000 square meters. And since January, we have already given about 68 such certificates to the buildings. Next year, we are planning to expand it to other 5 corporations in the state. And by 2020, the entire state will be covered under ECBC code. So that's point one. Point two, we are trying to do cool roofing, which is low-cost solution, and all the low-cost public housing buildings shall necessarily have cool roofings. All government buildings, we have a department called Roads and Buildings Department, so all buildings which are constructed by Road and Building Department will necessarily have cool roofing, and now we are, in fact, going for retrofitting of cool roofing as well as building codes for the existing buildings also. Third important point is that at the country level, we are coming out with what is called National Climate Action Plan. The draft is being released on Monday, and this is in compliance with kind of Kigali Amendment. So these are three major steps. In addition, in our state, for example, we have taken up increasing green cover on a very, very major scale. Right now, the green cover in the state is about 22%, and we have an ambitious program to increase it to 1/3 by 2022. So that's another step which is going on parallelly. Talking about AC, India's penetration in AC is only about 10% and going to increase to 40% by 2030. So whatever we are doing in renewable is kind of being offset by ACs if something is not done immediately. So that's one area we, I think, should be working on it.
Thanks very much. I'm jealous of having a new state. I wonder whether California could think about that in the context of the global process. Let me turn next, if I could, to Charlotte Pera, who is the CEO of the Climate Works Foundation, who's been working broadly on some of the global framing, in particular around the Kigali cooling work. Charlotte?
Yes, good morning, everyone. For those of you who don't know the Climate Works Foundation, we are a philanthropic organization that works globally to advance climate solutions. A little background, in September 2016, 18 foundations, some of whom are in this room, announced a joint commitment of $52 million to help developing countries transition to affordable, energy-efficient, clean cooling solutions. That announcement was the genesis of something we now call the Kigali Cooling Efficiency Program. We were one of those 18 foundations, and we now have the privilege of hosting the program secretariat. The timing of that announcement was important because it helped set the stage for the landmark agreement reached later that year in Kigali to amend the Montreal Protocol to phase down HFCs, a tremendously important outcome for the climate, as you heard from Durwood and Professor Ramanathan. The idea was also important because it added energy efficiency into the equation. We have a big opportunity to increase the benefits of the Kigali Amendment if we improve the energy efficiency of cooling equipment at the same time as we turn over product lines and so forth to phase down HFCs. The benefits of doing both of those things at the same time are enormous. Certainly the climate benefits alone are a huge prize, and that is what our foundation is primarily focused on. But we're also really excited about the ways in which affordable, energy-efficient cooling can dramatically improve people's lives. It can increase food supply. It can help vaccines and other medicines reach more people who need them. It can help prevent heat-related deaths, and so on and so on. We recently produced a report in partnership with Sustainable Energy for All that estimated that the health and livelihoods of more than 1 billion people worldwide are literally at risk due to lack of access to cooling. I thought that was a really stunning number. $52 million is very little money in the context of a $140 billion global cooling market, but we are working with great grantees and partners and advisors to put that funding to the best possible use and to leverage other public and private resources so we can really have impact at scale. In our first year, we provided direct support in 38 developing countries, Bangladesh, Mexico, Colombia, China, Thailand, Nigeria, many others, to help them, for example, develop national cooling plans, develop energy performance standards for cooling equipment. We worked with UN Environment to provide training for policymakers in 147 developing countries, and we're supporting other activity as well. It's too early to measure the impact of this work, although we're starting to see some outcomes, but we are optimistic that we'll see significant results. This isn't an announcement, but I share it as a very positive signal. Our KSEP team is in the middle of reviewing proposals and deciding how to award $10 million worth in grants specifically to mobilize public and private financing for clean cooling. We got a great response to our RFP. We received $75 million worth in generally very strong proposals that together would leverage about $1.5 billion in public and private financing. So we're excited about that. We see a lot of room and opportunity to shape the future of cooling, and in doing so, ensure that cooling contributes to our climate goals and improves people's lives in many other ways. And we look forward to continuing to work with everyone in this room and people outside this room to make those benefits real. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Charlotte. I'm struck in some ways by the relatively small things that we can do that can lead to such big changes in this sector. And what I wanted to just with a lightning round, because we're almost out of time here, go back around once and ask each of you, what's the thing that you think is the barrier that's holding us back from that next step, that next big thing we could do? And if we could do it, what else could you deliver? So just quickly for each person, let me start here.
Like I said when I started, regulations are key for industry to make investments in R&D and manufacturing. I applaud Senator Lara for what he's done in California. We need other states to follow through with that, and we will continue to invest as a company.
Great to hear. Charlotte.
So much that could be said. I'll say two things very quickly. I think it's critically important that we continue to work together across civil society, philanthropy, private sector, public sector to really get big things done. And then in the Kigali Cooling Efficiency Program in particular, I think we just need to keep going. We need more resources. So far, the program's entirely focused on air conditioning because of limitations in resources. We need to work on refrigeration, cold chain, et cetera.
Thanks very much. Rhea?
Well, I guess I can draw attention to the reality of the complete lack of national leadership here in the United States, which obviously
Did
is
you have
not
to?
Just, I know, it's hard to forget about, but in addition to HFCs, there's a whole host of other environmental and climate related policies that we're facing a lot of challenge in. But I will say, and I wanted to just underscore my remarks earlier, regardless of wherever the federal administration ends up, I think the reality that you have heard by the panelists on the stage today, people that represent billions of dollars worth of economic opportunity and business in this community, people that represent diverse communities within our states, people that represent donors and the interest in really leveraging investments for a better world. I mean, all of this is coming together in a pretty interesting way. So I feel kind of bad about the Trump administration, but I think that the momentum, particularly with this issue, is very clear, and I think we'll see more of that in, frankly, the next couple of weeks.
And it's incredibly exciting just listening to you all about where that's going. Senator?
I think, again, just to reiterate, one of the biggest obstacles we have is President Trump. I think where we can, as a state, continue to move forward is sending those strong market signals to businesses that we are not going back. We're going to continue to move forward. We're going to invest significant resources to make sure that we send those appropriate market signals so that we not only bring manufacturing back to the states, but actually send real targets with meaningful regulation and the appropriate market signals so that we continue to invest in these critical technologies that ultimately save lives.
Great, thanks very much. Arvind?
in Hyderabad, we have banned all conventional public transport modes, three-wheelers, et cetera, and we are only going for electric vehicles now. Likewise, garbage collection, it's only electric vehicles. So my issue now is that cost is an issue. How do we find cost-effective public transport, which becomes, we don't have to depend on subsidies, because subsidies model won't last. We need to work on the cost economics to see that they become actually viable for urban local bodies to kind of procure and make some sense out of it.
Thanks very much. Joe?
So I kind of echo what I said earlier. We'd like to see ratification of the Kigali Amendment, and maybe to take a little bit of a different tack. You know, the conversations we've had with the administration and the policy staff have actually been pretty productive and constructive. You know, I think it's certainly not happening as quickly as we'd like it by any stretch of the imagination, but I do want to say that they have been, you know, good discussions. They've asked some very good questions, and we've tried to deliver, I think, what are some credible answers to those questions, one of which is what the economic impact of ratification of the amendment is going to be. And I'm happy to say that, you know, from the economists that we've talked to and did some work, we've demonstrated that if we adopt and ratify the Kigali Amendment, we could create 33,000 additional manufacturing jobs. Not only in addition to those jobs, but we also slow the growth of the trade deficit within the HVACR industry. So there's some clear economic benefits that result as a result, you know, as if we ratify the Kigali Amendment. So, you know, we're trying to impart that to the administration. I know that they're concerned about the consumer impact, but, you know, I think we all recognize that if we address it from a national standpoint, it reduces the chance of bumpy sort of, you know, transition, which is what we're trying to avoid. But I think we've demonstrated that there's some clear economic benefits in addition to the environmental benefits for proceeding down with this policy.
Thanks so much. So I think what we've heard from this panel is both the scale of change that people are making, and it's extraordinary, and everybody here is contributing to it, but a couple of very discrete things we could do next to drive the agenda. And the opportunity here should not be understated. It's an extraordinary deliverable. It would change the climate temperature trend, but it would also work on human health. It would change the way people do business and jobs, we heard from Joe. It would change the way cities operate. It would change the way communities play, particularly the least, the disadvantaged ones. It would open up new business choices. There are ways to carry this forward. While the administration may be a barrier, it is clearly not the barrier for the action from this table, and it doesn't have to be the barrier that we have to worry about if we can all act. So I'd like to thank you all and really appreciate the work you're doing. Is this on? Yes. When you think about a panel process like this, and you're talking about a series of short-lived pollutants, about how to organize a conversation that's useful, and what we decided to do for this session is obviously break it into three parts. We had a discussion on black carbon, we had a discussion on HFCs, this is a discussion on methane. And I want to make very clear that very often methane's given a bit of a short shrift. People, it's the third item on the agenda, it may not be so important. One of the areas that we know well and that Dr. Ramanathan spoke to is that in climate change, we have a couple of problems. One is the absolute warming that we'll end up with. It's kind of a long-term function. But one is the rate of change and the near-term consequences. Methane is one of those gases that can, if addressed, fix that short-term problem. While we're working on carbon, If we work on methane and the short-lived pollutants, we can begin immediately to scale back on some of the worst of the damages that otherwise would occur. And what we have here is a panel doing exactly that, a group of really extraordinary partners and players thinking not only about this issue, but about many others, but they're here to talk to us first about this particular question. A lot of folks on the stage, but some really great talent. I want to start off first with Dr. Amory Lovins, known, I think, to many of you, one of the most interesting thinkers on this and on many, many other problems. He is the co-founder and chief scientist of the Rocky Mountain Institute and has a great deal to offer across the board. Amory?
Thank you. For all of us, the first self-endangered species, I have bad news and good news. The bad news is that the conservative climate models understated the speed and the runaway feedback potential of climate change. The good news is that the same models also understated the practical and profitable potential to prevent climate change. Offsetting these two effects, the race of our lives, the race for our lives, remains very much on, and despair is just as unwarranted as complacency. Let me focus on one of a half dozen opportunities that create new hope for climate. And that is the way to turn down the global thermostat even faster by quickly abating the super-polluter emissions of HFCs, ozone, soot, and especially methane. Neglecting them as minor trace gases or arguing about 20-year versus 100-year equivalences to CO2 creates confusion and obscures a vast opportunity. Because CO2 stays in the atmosphere a long time, we must reduce its cumulative emissions. While methane's effect is potent but brief, so we must reduce its rate of emissions. These two metrics are not equivalent. Let me offer you a metaphor. If you were atherosclerotic and at risk of long-term heart attack and stroke, so you should work on your diet and exercise, but you also happen to be hemorrhaging from a cut artery, do not waste time worrying about the equivalence factor between the rate of blood loss and the rate of plaque formation. Just stop the bleeding, basic first aid, so that you survive to be able to remedy your chronic condition. And methane emissions are like arterial bleeding. They're a top priority in planetary first aid. Now, the potential leverage is prompt and immense because a remarkably small reduction in methane emissions on the order of 25 megatons a year or less could rebalance the entire global methane cycle. And the oil and gas industries could profitably abate that much methane just from their own flares and engineered vents concentrated in a few thousand places in several thousand foreign sites. This is well written up by the International Energy Agency's World Energy Outlook 2017, which has this supply curve of abatement and cost in that industry. Now, many responsible oil and gas firms are now gradually stopping their own emissions, and they've long done that to near perfection with sour gas, whose highly toxic hydrogen sulfide, as toxic as cyanogen, would otherwise kill people. But also, of course, sweet gas emissions by anyone are toxic to their business. And one or more big oil or service companies could roll up this profitable opportunity to abate everyone's deliberate emissions, mobilize the American Petroleum Institute to raise the bar industry-wide, outperform near compliance, and not just stabilize, but reduce global warming. The Global Energy Outlook of IEA says just the oil and gas industry's profitable opportunity to do that would be like avoiding 160 gigatons of CO2 emissions to 2100. That's like instantly decarbonizing all developed country existing homes, or all existing Chinese coal-fired power stations, or half of all future automobiles. It's as if we just found a small but extremely useful hidden handbrake to slow down our runaway carbon train. Let's pull that brake hard right now, and the firms that do it first will be heroes to their shareholders and to us all. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Amory. I'm struck both by his comment here, but broadly by its application to all of our short-lived pollutants around stopping the bleeding. There's something to be said for that. And the next panelist here who will speak to us is Fred Krupp, whom I think is known also to many of you. He's the president of the Environmental Defense Fund, and in that context has been one of the leaders in fact, staunching that bleeding. Fred?
Thanks, Jonathan. And that was great context, Amory. Appreciate that very much. You know, earlier this week, President Trump's administration proposed rolling back the regulations on methane that this country has had in place since 2016. That's a big deal, and I want to put that in context. Methane is causing over one quarter of all the global warming that we're experiencing right now. And that's why reducing oil and gas emissions by the 75% that IEA says is necessary is such a big deal. The good news is that the Trump administration has been at this since day one. The first time Senator McCain put his thumb down was not health care. It was to kill the attempt to repeal the oil and gas BLM methane rules. Five times since, the Environmental Defense Fund and its allies has beaten back both EPA and the BLM from repealing the rules in court. We're now working to prevent the administration from this latest move, which is to weaken the rules. And the good news there is there's something else we can do about it. So EDF announced earlier this year that we're going to launch a satellite to detect methane with more precision and more coverage than has ever been launched before or that is even planned. The importance of transparency is that it can lead to accountability. So the satellite and the data alone won't result in the reduction we need, but it gives us the data to know which oil companies are cleaning up their emissions and which ones aren't. There's really no single better opportunity that I'm aware of to lower the temperatures that we're otherwise going to see in the next 20 years than methane abatement from agriculture, from the oil and gas industry, from coal bed methane. This is our chance to prevent the risk of feedback loops that could tip the planet completely out of balance. Whatever that risk is, we minimize that risk by lowering the temperatures over the next 20 years. So I just think there's an urgency here, and the fact that the costs are minimal for the oil and gas industry for that sector is critical. Landfills are another important source as well. I'd leave it there, Jonathan.
Thanks very much, Fred. One of the things that I am struck by is how technology can help us in this process. A decade ago, you could not have imagined an NGO, no matter how big it was, thinking about its own satellite. And today we have the capacity for a group like Fred's to think about this kind of a process, provide global information with a level of specificity that we couldn't have imagined before. It doesn't mean the government's not relevant, of course it is, but what it means is that we don't have to wait. We can do things, and leaders like Fred and his team are in fact delivering on that.
Jonathan, just one more point. It's not only satellites, as you know, it's the fact that wind power has come way down in price. New technologies make the solutions more affordable. And all these pollutants, the thing that's been working against us, is they are invisible. When we make what's been invisible visible, everything changes. So the fact that we can install air pollution sensors in cities around the globe and make conventional air pollution known and the health, damaging health effects that are happening. We did this right here in West Oakland. We found out people are dying prematurely because of too much air pollution. When you have three sensors in a city on top of a building, there's no visibility. When you have every street mapped by foot, you get visibility and action.
Thanks, Fred. You mentioned the issue of agriculture. It's a major source. We have here with us today Emily Rooney, who's the president of the Agricultural Council of California. Tell us a bit about what you're doing and how you see the solutions to this problem.
Absolutely. Thank you, Jonathan. I'm here today on behalf of California's dairy industry and the dairy families across California. We've committed collectively to reduce methane production by 40% below 2013 levels by the year 2030. So how are we doing that? We are doing that through two basic areas of work. One is the advancement of climate smart agricultural practices, and the other is right around generation of renewable energy, such as dairy digesters. Through those two sort of areas of work, we have seen expansion in those areas in a way that's really transforming the dairy industry. Now, it's important to note, I just want to make a very important note here that these technologies are not inexpensive, and this absolutely cannot be done without the state of California stepping up alongside California dairies families in an effort to reduce methane. Dairy families oftentimes run on very tight profit margins. Oftentimes they are negative, so there's not a lot of financial flexibility in order to make those investments. But California has stepped up with investment of climate change and cap and trade dollars to assist with a dairy digester program and also a program around alternative manure management practices for dairies that just don't have the feasibility to get a digester off the ground. You know, and it's really starting to transform the dairy industry. It's kind of exciting. When we started this process, there were about 12 or 14 digesters in the state. And now with the recent round of grant funds, we have 80 dairy digesters either actively operating or in the works. And in addition to that, we have 56 alternative manure management projects that are also aimed at reducing or avoiding methane production. So you've got well over 100 projects underway to capture, avoid, or reduce methane on farm. And we're pretty excited about that. So the dairy industry, you're going to see transformation from just beyond milking cows to developing cow power, and we're very excited about that.
That's fabulous news. Congratulations on all that activity going forward. Let me turn for the moment. We've got some conversation here around a number of sectors, been a lot of it on the U.S. and some international flavor, but turn to my colleague from China, Mr. Niu Jiansheng, who can talk a bit about what's going on in China and work that you are involved with there on this front. And I know that he'll speak in Chinese, but we'll have a translator to give us his words in just a moment. Please.
那么非常的高兴啊，能够参加这个组织今天的一个大家的对话和交流。 那么由于语言的问题，大家没有同穿，我说的话你们也听不懂，反正你们主持人也好，其他人说的话我也听不懂，因此呢，只能有一个后边的翻译，大致上翻译我的意思。那么下面呢，你先开始。
I'm so glad to be here, but it's a pity today we have no interpreter equipment for everyone. So I need my translator to help me today. I just see my ideas and writing down my ideas. My translator helped me to speak to all of you. Thank you.
所以说前边的人我说了什么不重要，重要的是后边这个女士说了什么非常重要。嗯。
What I mentioned, I cannot understand the speakers on the stage, but I only get the little message. But I found the ladies, the speech is very important.
Thank you. 那么刚才我们这位女士，加州的这个啊农业部，谈到这个关于甲烷的事，就是牛和有关系的事，因为我们知道啊这个二氧化碳和这个甲烷的比例是28倍以上。 至少将近30倍。那么，作为如果怎么样把甲烷变成资源，而不是跑到空中把空气变成气候沙漠，这是我们早期研究过的问题。当年我在做养牛啊厂的时候，牛奶的时候，牛粪和牛尿啊每天有差不多的一个集中的牧场有10000000吨，所以怎么样把牛尿和牛粪处理成啊沼气，然后又发了电，怎么样送到啊有益的地方？ 那么同时呢，也怎么能把这个空中的沙漠问题解决了？所以这个事情呢，他翻译说的比我更清楚。好。
So I have to translate the following. So I did the investigation very earlier time. I found that the research suggested that the greenhouse effect of the methane is 28 times more than that of the carbon dioxide. So that's the reason why when I was doing the business in the dairy, I try my best to use the, you know, the power of the plant handled 12,000 tons of the cattle marine and the urine annually. So reducing the equivalent carbon dioxide by 55,000 tons and generating more than 9.6 million degrees of electricity each year. So at that time, in the United UNDP awarded the project as the capacity building project to accelerate the renewable energy in China. So it's awarded as a demonstration project in China because of the technology promotion. So so we can see that messy is a very serious problem for China as well. So I also have a comparison. We called, if we want to compare the ideal or the pleasant climate to be, it's a kind of like a grassland in the air, then the methane and the carbon dioxide and other greenhouse gases is a kind of like a desert in the air. So I think these reasons cause the climate, I call the climate desertification. So impairment of the soil diversification is usually regional. But the impact of climate desertification is global. So whether in the eastern or western hemisphere, or whether in the southern or the northern hemisphere, people of the world have to endure the results, either good or bad. So it's very pushing, and it's a very serious problem we should face with.
Thank you so much. 那么因为这个事儿呢，联合国还给发了个奖，也不知道说没说，因为联合国发了个再生能源奖，2006年给我们，就因为这个甲烷变成沼气，沼气变成发电。
Yeah, I want to emphasize that. So this is the practice in China. So, but in China, we really the first ones doing this good work. So that's reason why I want to emphasize UNDP award the project. The full name is Capacity Building Project to accelerate the commercialized of renewable energy in China, because it's a large scale demonstration project of biogas power generation technology promotion.
Thank you so much. I'm struck in some ways by these last two partners who've just spoken to us about the opportunity. If we think about how we're going to feed the world, if we think about the food supply and where it's going to go, we have to also think about its consequences. But what we heard from both of these speakers is that there is considerable room. There are technologies. There are ways to manage it. They're innovative. They're new. But they can fundamentally alter the trajectory, and we can do this, and it's being done. Let me turn next and last to our speaker, Bob Fisher. He's the co-founder and trustee of the Pisces Foundation. One of the things that I think is really important about the process is that very little of it happens in unique, singular silos. They're done through collaboration. They're done through people working together to find solutions, and Bob's no better a person than Bob to speak about some of those kinds of collaborations.
Well, Jonathan, thank you very much. And first, I'd like to start by thanking Ryan McCarthy and Mary Nichols for getting this session on the agenda. This is an incredibly important topic, as Amory spoke about. 50% of current warming comes from these super pollutants. And I guess we're relegated to an hour and a half, but when CO2 is a topic, it seems to take all the oxygen out of the room. Jonathan, you brought up some very good points. As a business leader and as a philanthropist, I look for opportunities. And one of the opportunities that we saw very early on was to focus on super pollutants. And we're focused on the three pollutants that are being discussed in the room today. There are opportunities to do things now. These are generally not things that will cost a lot of money, especially in methane. We can really tackle the methane problem immediately and at virtually no cost. And we need to do this. We need to do more of it. We need to do it faster. Because if we can do it faster, we're buying ourselves time. As Amory spoke about, carbon accumulates in the atmosphere. And the super pollutants, while certainly not benign, go away much quicker. And if we can aggressively do this, and with many of the cost-effective methods, we get health benefits, and there's also an opportunity to collaborate greatly among many different institutions. I'm proud to see many of the organizations and individuals that the Pisces Foundation funds up here. And this is what we're focused on. I think there's an opportunity for a lot of philanthropists. If they want to get great bang for their buck, there is no better place to do that than in the Super-Pollutant area. Thanks.
Thanks very much, Bob. I just want to thank all of the panelists here on this panel in particular, because I think one of the things we have to worry about is this rate of change that Amory talked about. We don't actually have a lot of time. In fact, we're past due, and the bleeding is not just serious, it's enormously life-threatening. And we're seeing the damages, we're seeing evacuations, we're seeing fundamental droughts, we're seeing consequences that are enormously severe. And what we've heard from this panel are a set of ideas about how we can, as Amory said, stop the bleeding. And we're hearing it from China, we're hearing it around NGO communities, we're hearing it from the farming sector, we're hearing it from philanthropy. There are things to do, and this panel is doing them. I'd like to give them a really warm round of applause for the work that they're taking on, and thank them for that. So as the panel is exiting, I wanted to introduce the next and final speaker for this session. I had the great privilege myself of working in the Obama administration, where I served as the special envoy for climate change. And among other things that I got to work on when I was there, I was able to help establish the Climate and Clean Air Coalition. That's a group that's been, I think, quite influential, very instrumental in this agenda. They picked up all three of these short-lived pollutants. They made an effort to think about how do you expand the reach of the agenda beyond carbon dioxide and think about how you carry us forward in next steps to solve this problem, thinking not only about the long term, which we know we have to worry about, but about the short term. And the next speaker is the current co-chair of the CCAC, the Climate and Clean Air Coalition. She is also the Secretary of Environment for the country of Kenya. She, in that capacity, is not only leading a global initiative, but also leading a series of domestic actions, and has taken the steps necessary to really reduce greenhouse gas emissions at home and to help shepherd the global community into deep reductions internationally. She's a champion. She's someone I think we all should look up to. She speaks on behalf of the entire three panelists that we just heard from across all of those sectors. Speaks for the future of the world. If we take a look going forward, the continent of Africa is going to be a central player bigger than China. How do we think about these agendas? She's here to tell us a bit more of what comes next, how she sees the solutions, and to carry us forward. So with that in mind, let me introduce Dr. Alice Caudia. Thanks very much to all of you.
I'm left alone, but you're here with me, so I still feel comfortable. I hope the mic is sounding enough. Yeah, as you have heard from many speakers today, reducing short-lived climate pollutants is vital if we want to keep warming to 1.5 degrees Celsius. I'm very pleased to be here as one of the leaders of Climate and Clean Air Coalition. We are today releasing the ministerial and partner declaration in which we are committing to lead global actions that will lead to avoiding 0.6 degrees temperature increase between now and 2050 through actions to mitigate short-lived climate pollutants, or as they are called here, super pollutants. This is important in the aspect of health, benefits to all, and particularly for those of us from developing countries. We are launching with our 61 country and 60 partner organizations our submissions to the United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change and the Talanoa Dialogue, our statement on paths towards what we believe will lead to attainment of the temperature goals of the Paris Agreement. Let me take a breather and make reference to my country, Kenya. Kenya is working to reduce the super pollutants by moving to cleaner household energy, including stoves, by improving our waste management systems, and moving to cleaner fuels in the transport sector. And this is because it's estimated that 18 million Kenyans die annually out of exposure to short-lived climate pollutants. The solutions are ready now, and we are taking action. I think that has been the brand of this summit, that action is the word, and action we are calling for from all of us. So this is an open call to all countries and other stakeholders to sign on this statement. It will stay open until COP24, and I invite all of you to sign on it and join us so that we can ensure we take fast action for quick results for multiple benefits. That is the signage of CCAC. Fast action, quick results, multiple benefits. I would like now to invite the Honorable Minister for Climate and Environment of Norway, Mr. Ola Elvestuen, to say a few words about of our collective submission. Minister, please.
Thank you, and thank you for your leadership. Slowing the rate of warming in the near term is crucial to reach the long-term targets of the Paris Agreement and the Sustainable Development Goals by 2030. Climate change is happening faster than ever, and we see that records are broken every year. Even in Norway, we had the driest summer ever recorded this summer. And I visited the Arctic also this summer. And I mean, you can really see the changes and see how the glaciers are melting when you come there year after year. It is it is urgent that we start and we reduce emissions immediately. And as leaders, we need to send a strong message to the world that climate change in the near term matters. To succeed in the long term, we need to choose a path that will slow the rate of global warming in the near term. By reducing both short-lived climate pollutants, methane, black carbon, and HFCs, and working on the long-lived gases like CO2, we increase our chances of success. And succeed we must. Action with near-term impacts also has so many benefits for air quality, human health, and agricultural productivity. Taking this path increases our chances of reaching the Sustainable Development Goals. The Climate and Clean Air Coalition offers tools to identify measures with multiple benefits. These measures are low-hanging fruits with available technologies that can be implemented quickly. This we can start and we can do it now. I'm therefore happy to be here today to launch our submission to the Talanoa Dialogue along with all my good CCAC colleagues. Thank you.
All right, thanks everyone. This concludes the session.